Chapter 22, The Causeway. Those wounded, who could, stumbled their way back from the city gates along the causeway. A few were assisted by their brothers in arms. Elves, men alike, hobbled back, bleeding, bruised, impaled, to the makeshift infirmary on the mainland. Caitlin and Talia scrambled to help the elves, who used their healing arts where they could to save some, and soothe others who were beyond saving. Human healers followed the guidance of the elves, whose knowledge was well beyond their own. Caitlin and Talia quickly learned how to fasten tourniquets, clean wounds, and apply salves when needed. Both were soon covered in blood, as if they had been wounded themselves. The sight was jarring to Caitlin. Each time she looked at Talia, she had to remind herself that the girl was not injured, and that the blood that drenched her clothes, forearms, and hands, mixing with the paint on her face, was that of fighters and not hers. The battle had moved into the castle walls. The ashes of the doors had been trampled underfoot and pulverized into a cloud of dust. Now the fires had moved into the city, clouds of smoke rising up against the morning sky, creating a false gloaming. The smell of burning buildings and even flesh left a stink in the air, while the wounded retreated back with rent flesh, missing limbs, and broken bones. And those were the ones who lived. "How goes the fight within the walls?" Caitlin asked a man with an arrow in his shoulder and another in his gut. He had been helped back by a younger man, limping with an arrow in his thigh.
"The men fight valiantly, as do the elves," he said,
looking askance at the she-elf beside him also laying wounded, her armor torn open, her flesh a mess of blood, ripped clothes, and broken ringmail.
"But those things, they are monsters."
The she-elf groaned, and the man reached for her hand. Caitlin knew from her brief time already with the casualties that the she-elf would not survive her injuries.
"Water," she begged.
Caitlin knew she should save the precious water for those who might need it to clean wounds that were not mortal, but she found herself unable to deny this she-elf's request. She tipped a bottle to her lips while her lifeblood spread out on the grass below.
"I'll take it," the man said,
cradling the she-elf's head in one hand, the bottle in the other.
"See to some others."
By others, she knew he meant those who would live. Caitlin nodded, stepped away, and wiped her hands on her thighs, knowing the stains on her trousers would never come out.
"Caitlin, look,"
Talia said from beside her, pointing with her own bloody fingers. Lumbering after the fleeing wounded was a gray vorg. He had broken off from the battle within the walls to chase down the men and elves who were wounded and fleeing. In one arm was a flail, in another an axe. A half-dozen arrows struck out from his torso, but he still swung his weapons with brutal efficiency. Talia searched the hillside about them for someone who might take the fight to this gray, but there were no warriors left who were not wounded. Talia cursed in her own tongue and ran to where her horse was tethered.
"Talia, what are you doing?"
"We have to stop him."
"It's a gray. We can't."
"We have to try," she said, mounting. "What will we do if it reaches the end of the causeway and comes up the hill? We'll have to fight him anyway."
Caitlin did not feel their chances of prevailing were good either way, but neither could she let Talia ride to confront the monster alone. She jumped onto her own horse and heard someone call after her.
"Wait!"
Certain that it was someone who would speak sense into both of them, she was surprised when she turned to see the young man who had carried his comrade from the causeway, an arrow still lodged in his thigh.
"I can't walk well, but I can ride. I'll come too."
"Best hurry.
Talia is not waiting," Caitlin said as Talia spurred her horse down the slope to the causeway. "We're all mad," she thought, as the young man winced, climbing onto a spare horse, the blood from his wound dripping from his boot into the stirrups.
"I'm Kip," he gasped.
"Caitlin," she said, kicking her own mount to follow Talia. They passed a few wounded fighters on their way up the hill, and more on the causeway. They were too late to save his last victim, a wounded graybeard who had grown too weak to continue and had sat down against the side of the bridge. The Vorg showed him no mercy and looked up from his kill to fix his eyes on Talia, who pulled on her reins to stop with one hand and readied her spear with the other. Only Kip and Caitlin's arrival gave him any pause as he considered the three of them.
"We're overmatched," Caitlin said, hoping to reason with Talia, whose face paint was streaked with sweat, her hair stuck to her temples. But before they could make a retreat to higher ground, the gray charged. So did Talia, kicking her horse and riding it into the monster. Her horse reared and thrashed out with its hooves. The Vorg stepped left to flank Talia, but Kip was there and met him, swinging his sword at the beast. The blade glanced off the Vorg's rust-eaten armor with a shower of sparks. Closer now, the Vorg used its claws to slash at Kip's horse, spilling blood from its neck. Talia took advantage of the opening to launch her spear at the Vorg's own neck, but her aim failed her, and the spear point clanked off the monster's breastplate. With another swipe from his claws, Talia's horse was also slain. It fell sideways, trapping her foot beneath its bulk. The Vorg closed in on Talia as she tried to work her foot free, but the horse was too heavy for her. "I'm sorry," Caitlin thought, spurring her own horse forward into the gap, knowing the Vorg would make another quick kill. Her horse shuddered under her as the Vorg raked its chest with his claws, but his strike was not fatal. Caitlin's horse reared, throwing her before it fled down the causeway. Her side was aching from her landing, and her breath came in shallow gasps, but Caitlin knew she had to move. She forced herself to her feet just as the Vorg was winding up his arm to swing his whip. It was Kip who limped into the space between them and took the blow. The whip struck him across the chest, snapping loud on his boiled leather armor, but he leaned into the blow, wrapped his arm with the whip, and pulled the slack tight. For a moment, he and the gray were engaged in a tug of war, before Kip swung his sword and cut the whip in two. The suddenness of the break sent Kip tumbling off to the side. He cried out as he landed on his wounded leg. Talia, free now, charged the distracted Vorg and sunk her short sword through a gap in its leg armor, driving it into the creature's knee. The gray stomped, trying to shake the sword free. Caitlin knew she had to act, to strike, but saw no opening. It would be enough if she simply drew the Vorg's attention, so she picked up Talia's spear from where it had fallen and flung it at the creature's face. It struck true, but there was not enough force behind the throw, the point glancing off its leather skin. The attack had its intended effect, though, for the Vorg turned his attention from Talia and even Kip, who, recovered, swung his sword again at the Vorg's elbow and opened a gash to the bone. He had stepped too close, however, and the Vorg turned to him with his axe and hammered it into Kip's middle, doubling him over. "Kip!"
Caitlin watched as the Vorg kicked the young man free of his axe head. Kip reeled, falling against the side of the bridge. His leathers opened, revealing a terrible, bloody wound. Talia scrambled over the carcass of her horse, took hold of the handle of her sword, and twisted it free of the Vorg's knee. The toothy mouth opened in a wild cry of pain, the knee buckling. The Vorg caught Talia with a backhanded swipe. She spun, dropping her sword, and collapsed on the ground, dazed. It was Caitlin's turn again. Gone were the moments for a careful strike or calculated parry. The fight had degenerated into a desperate contest, and she made any attack she could, swinging her sword with all her weight. Again, her blows were ineffective, bouncing off the plates of armor. She was a fly biting a bull, and when the Vorg turned on her, she found herself bereft of strategy, except to ready herself to run. The Vorg dragged his injured leg forward. His whip was halved, and Caitlin out of range of his axe swing, so he moved closer while she continued to back away. At least she could draw him from the others. Talia was still down, but Kip rose from behind the Vorg, cast himself onto his back, and wrapped the length of whip around the monster's neck. His knees against the hump on the creature's spine, Kip pulled, his arm muscles swelling.
The monster's slit eyes bulged. Kip tightened the grip and pushed off from the Vorg's shoulder, twisting over the edge of the bridge, bracing his shaking legs on the side so that he balanced over the surface of the water. His tendons corded, his teeth were bared and eyes squeezed almost shut, but Kip persisted. The Vorg strained.
"His legs! Trip his legs!" Kip said.
Caitlin searched the ground for the spear once more. It had landed a few feet away. This time she aimed for the Vorg's clawed feet, stabbing the spear point down between two talons. It lifted its foot in a panicked reflex. It was just enough for it to lose grip and slide towards the edge of the bridge. Kip wound the remaining slack around his forearm, released his legs, and let himself fall. Caitlin gasped as he disappeared over the side. The length of whip went taut, snapping back the Vorg's neck, toppling him, and flipping him over the side, leaving a swath of dark blood behind. Caitlin rushed to the side and looked into the water. Aside from the foam of bubbles on the waving surface of the harbor, there was no sign of Kip or the Vorg. She collapsed against the bridge, breathing hard, trembling, as she had after she had slain the Rachne. She surveyed the carnage immediately around her, becoming aware of the cries and the clash of arms in the plaza beyond the city gate. They had to move. She crawled over to Talia.
"Is it dead?" she asked.
"Thanks to Kip," Caitlin said. Talia pushed herself up, Caitlin helping. They gathered what weapons they could. Caitlin was relieved to see Talia seemed to have her fill of combat and was making her way back to the mainland. But both of them stopped when they heard their names.
"Caitlin! Talia!"
They turned to see Nathan running just under the portcullis, the wreckage of the shell still holding the iron gate open. His face was dark with soot, his clothes disheveled, as if he had been wrestling for his life.
"Nathan! Come, help! Gunther is hurt!"
There was no denying his request. They both ran as fast as they could towards the gate, towards the fighting.
"Are you all right?"
he asked, looking at their blood-stained clothes.
"Yes, it's others' blood, mostly." "Where is Gunther?"
Talia asked.
"Just inside the gate. A Vorg stabbed him."
Nathan led them over the bodies strewn about the smoking gate into the plaza on the far side. The battle had moved from the center of the plaza into the streets that led deeper into the city, the Vorgs having fallen back to their barricades. Caitlin saw Caelleef and Lazalorn leading a contingent of fighters down an avenue after a retreating horde of Vorgs. A stone's throw away, Hale and Violin rounded a corner on an alleyway and disappeared from sight. Val, Cody, Chloe, and Gale were in the center of the worst of the fighting. But, to her relief, Caitlin counted more allies than enemies, more fallen Vorgs than fallen elves and humans.
"Caitlin, come!"
Talia called to her. She turned and followed her friend, who was close on the heels of Nathan. Gunther was where Nathan had left him, leaning against a stairway that led up the side of the city wall. The bodies of burnt and disemboweled Vorgs that Nathan had slain with his power were scattered about in a circle of carnage.
"We were pushed in with the wave of fighters coming down the causeway," Nathan said. "We tried to help by forging spells against the Vorgs, but we got outnumbered and isolated."
"Lucky you prevailed," Caitlin said as they came to Gunther. He looked up, but his face showed worry, not relief.
"Caitlin, Talia, what are you doing here?"
"Helping you," Nathan replied. "Take his legs."
Gunther cried out as Caitlin and Talia each took a leg. He had been wounded by an arrow in his hip and could not walk. Nathan lifted him at the shoulders and they carried him, painfully slow, towards the gate. They only traveled a few steps before they had to set him down to rest.
"This is madness. You all should get to safety. Leave me."
Gunther's words went unheard as Talia cried,
"Nathan, watch out!"
Nathan turned as three green imps approached, wings snapping, claws tearing at the cobblestones of the plaza. Nathan dropped Gunther and sent up a wall of flame that caught the three Vorgs, turning them into fleeing fireballs.
"Come on," Nathan said,
taking up Gunther's weight again, but they only made it a few more feet when the commotion across the plaza grabbed their attention. The Vorgs had counterattacked. Elves and men were falling and fleeing before a shape that barreled through their numbers. A similar retreat was taking place on the opposite side of the plaza, the source the same, the Rachnae. The dark elks plowed through the human and elven fighters alike, sending them flying with swipes from the antlers. Caitlin's skin went cold, from her temples to her toes, as she recognized the blue-black leader of the Vorgs mounted on the back of one of the Rachnae. She had last seen him on the edge of the River Gilithwain, on the farthest reaches of Sidon, among the horde of Vorgs that had chased them to the edge of their territory. He was their hideous chief, their malevolent king. One of his arms was missing, torn from his body by the vines of the forest. With the arm that remained, he wielded a poleaxe. It was bright with the blood of those who had challenged him and had lost. Before her eyes, he swung the axe and cast down a band of elves and men in his midst, right before trampling them under the hooves of the elk. Oh no. Nathan felt Gunther tense in his arms as they watched Gale, Val, Cody, and Chloe move to confront the dark elk and his fearsome rider.
"We should help them," Gunther said as his wife rushed into danger.
"We have other problems," Talia said.
The second elk, this one riderless, was bearing down on them, his rack of antlers lowered, his nostrils flaring.
"Back to the stairs," Nathan cried.
They gathered up Gunther and beat a path for the stairs, dragging the wounded weather worker up behind them. Caitlin pushed aside the body of a dead Vorg and then a dead elf, sending them tumbling down the stairs. The elk took both in his antlers and flung them aside, then placed a hoof on the bottom stair. It only reached the second step before Darrett emerged from the chaos of the plaza and swung his sword at the elk's neck. It pivoted, caught his blow on its antlers, and heaved him backwards. Then it reared and dropped its hooves at Darrett's head. He did not retreat. Instead, he drove forward, slashed the elk's belly, opening a long red gash. The strike cost him, for the elk was close enough to catch the Corinthian on the point of an antler and send him spinning to the side. Darrett tripped over the bodies littered on the ground, but balanced himself on a knee, just in time to parry the oncoming thrust of the elk. He reached to his back, drew a second short sword from a scabbard there, and locked both in the elk's antlers, his face red with exertion.
"We have to help," Nathan said.
His own scabbard was empty.
"Caitlin, give me your sword."
Caitlin drew it and tossed it to him before she and Talia pulled Gunther up another stair. Nathan descended. His powers were barely recovered, but he forced a mild bolt of power into the elk's flank, if nothing else to draw its attention. It turned its head to watch Darrett from one eye, Nathan from the other. Then it made a feint for Nathan. Nathan foolishly bit, dodging to the side. But the elk must not have considered him a real threat, for its true target was still Darrett, who had also been fooled. He had stepped forward, left himself unprotected, only to be assailed by the elk, an antler slipping beneath his shoulder plate and skewering his arm. Darrett winced, his arm going limp and dropping one of his swords. He flung the other at the elk, but the angle was all wrong and it slipped harmlessly to the ground. Now the Rachnae marched forward, building up into a gallop, and drove Darrett into the city wall beneath the stairs. Caitlin and Talia cried out, "Darrett!" His hands uselessly clutching the antlers, tried to free himself. Nathan readied his sword and rushed in, aiming for the tendons in the elk's hind legs. But the creature was wise to him again and shot out a leg, striking him square in the face. The impact was sharp and tremendous. Stars swam before Nathan's eyes, and a ringing buzzed in his ears. He knew he was stumbling, as if drunk to the side, but he could not feel his legs. He didn't even know if he was still holding his sword. All he could focus on was not falling, even though that was all his body wanted to do. In his pain and dizziness, he somehow managed to stagger away, away from the elk and away from the stairs. He was facing the battle now, observing it in a detached manner. His thoughts loose and unconnected, he imagined he saw Hale and Violin leading a line of prisoners to safety. He noted a surge of fighters, the roaring Vorgs, and a face that he knew. Among the figures, and there were many now in the plaza, he saw a face that he recognized. It was one he had not seen in years, but he knew him when he saw him. The face from many years ago, on the island of his home, when he had been taken away from his parents. The face of his master. The face of the Magus. Then he fell forward and knew no more. Nathan spun backwards from the blow from the elk's hind leg, staggered for a few steps, and then collapsed face down in the plaza. Caitlin called out to him, but he did not move, even as the battle shifted, and a stream of people emerged, led by Violin and Hale. Men, women, children fleeing the catacombs where they had been trapped. Now liberated by Hale and Violin, they ran for the gate. But the Vorgs were after them, taking down stragglers. Violin and Hale led a contingent of fighters against them, defending the escapees as best they could, but it left no one to help Darid.
Except us.
Talia, hot-blooded as she was, realized this first. She scampered down the stairs, picked up a hand axe from a dead Vorg, and struck at the elk's flank. The weapon bit into its flesh, but the elk did not release Darid. Instead, it further slammed him against the wall, further impaling him. Talia reached for the hand axe where it was lodged in the elk's mounded muscle, but it was stuck fast. With a shake of its head, the elk dropped Darid to the ground, then swung for Talia. Being small worked to her advantage. She rolled beneath the elk's swing and stopped just under its belly. But she was weaponless and helpless. Caitlin's own sheath was empty, her sword lying next to Nathan. She patted her belt, looking for a knife, anything, when her hand touched something smooth, not metal, not bone. The antler from the Rachne they had slain at the lake. She drew it out, called to Talia, and tossed it down to her. It spun in the air, glittering not unlike Adamantus' own crown of antlers. The flash of light caught the dark elk's eye, which rolled to the corner of its socket, tracing the path downward from the stairs as it tumbled through the air to Talia's outstretched hand. By some miracle she caught it, and in the same motion she swept it upwards in an arc, burying it deep into the elk's chest. She struck true, and must have found the heart, for she was quickly drenched in a shower of blood, baptized as if in some barbaric ritual. She thrust farther, her teeth white in a mask of red. Caitlin could see all the force of righteous vengeance for her people, her friends, and family in Talia's wild eyes, eyes that closed, sensual with relief, as the elk's own eyes went wide, its mouth gaped open, and it sidestepped, trembling. Then Chloe was there, and sank a lance into the creature's side with a scream. She was followed by Val, Gale, Cody, and others, but the wounds they inflicted were only hastening the inevitable. Talia had struck the fatal blow. The elk fell over, dead at their feet. Something had shifted. The Vorgs were no longer attacking, but fleeing, their resurgence broken. The blue-black leader in his gold armor was retreating. Caitlin tried to account for all her friends. Chloe was already climbing the stairs to Gunther's side. Val and Cody were tending to Darid, who had come too and was leaning on his elbow. Gale, once assured that her master was safe, stood up, her face an inscrutable mix of relief and dissatisfaction. She looked across the plaza at the fleeing shape of the last Rachne, with its Vorg rider. "There is still one left to finish," she said, and was gone. As Gale raced across the pools of blood spread on the cobblestones, Caitlin noticed Violin peel off from where she fought beside her brothers to follow Gale. Hale was nowhere to be seen, but she assumed he was with the other fleeing Kyrissanians, making for the safety of the mainland by the causeway. With Gunther now in Chloe's care, Caitlin slid down the steps on her backside, landed with a thud, and ran over to where she had seen Nathan fall. But he was gone.